Well, what's it been like year two as opposed to last spring coming out here?
It's been great. It's anytime you're in a second year offense, it's a completely different feel from, you know, when you first start, you're installing plays, you're installing alignments, and you're talking about guys just trying to understand what they're doing. Now you can really detail it up. You can talk about the intricacies of the route. You can experiment with new plays, new motions, all kinds of different fun things. So it's been really good. I think the guys have really enjoyed it.
Do you sense some of the veterans in the system, even like a young guy like Breece Hall, they feel more confident and they'll be able to move quicker because they have a better grasp of the system?
Without a doubt. I mean, you look at, you know, guys like Garrett, guys like Breece, those two guys came in the first year, had a whole system change. So I had to learn a whole new system. They didn't even have that same system 2 years in a row. To now, this is their first time having the system 2 years in a row. Guys like Xavier, you know, being able to come in and have a second year in the same system. So he's not, again, learning what this route is. Now he's truly running the route.
How does the system change? Because after four snaps last year, you had to totally alter what you were doing because Aaron is a central part of what you were going to do in 2023.
Yes. I mean, when you have a guy like Aaron, you want to build everything around him. I think anybody would want to do that. And when he went down, we had to make adjustments. I still think about that game quite a bit. You know, I give so much credit to that group being able to come together and still find a way to win that football game. And but yeah, you have to make changes. You have to work with the guys that you have. And having Aaron back, we get to work with him. Having a guy like Tyrod Taylor, another veteran experienced guy, it allows you to do a lot of those things.
You were just talking about Garrett before, and I mentioned Breece. What does it say about them? Like you were talking about that it was their second year in the National Football League, and they were still able to produce like that. Garrett played with four different quarterbacks last year, becomes the first Jet ever in back-to-back seasons to start a career, go over 1,000 yards receiving. And then you got Breece, who's playing in a new system. You have quarterback instability, and he still goes for more than 1,500 yards from scrimmage off an ACL.
Yeah, no, it's impressive. I mean, you look at Breece and just, you know, the amount of work that he put in to get back and be able to play at a high level. And he was a little slow to start as he was working himself back in. But watching him slowly get better and better as the season went, I mean, that check down versus the Giants that went for 50, I mean, shows what he's capable of. You can throw him a 2 yard pass and he could go the distance. A guy like Garrett, to have so many different guys in his first 2 years throw him the football and still be able to have the production that he has, you know, it's a credit to those guys. And it's frustrating at times because you want to have consistency across the board. But they've, you know, kept their heads down. They do their job and they continually try to strive to get better.
Different personalities, but can you talk about the similarities with Garrett and Breece? Breece was just talking before. He said, you know, I probably had too many drops last year. And Garrett's always talking about, I haven't done anything in the National Football League yet.
You know, Breece, I mean, it was crazy to think that those two guys were 1-2 in most receptions,
right?
I believe. I think it was right around there with Conklin in there. But, you know, Breece is a humble guy. You know, I mean, both of them are humble guys, but they're very fiery competitors. And you know, there were a lot of opportunities that we could have taken advantage of to get him the ball more, I think. And we need to take advantage of those. And Garrett, you know, I mean, just to be able to get the production that he has, like I said, without that consistency, you know, when you get that consistency, it's going to be fun to watch him out there.
What's different about those guys? Because I don't think you get the sense just watching on TV as opposed to maybe coming out here and taking in practice like we have the opportunity to. You're coaching on the field, but Garrett just moves differently than other people. Can you speak to that?
The thing with Garrett is he truly wants the ball every play. And whether, you know, it's there or not there, I mean, it's whether, you know, we could do something different. I mean, he just wants to make as many plays as he can. I mean, he is the ultimate competitor. I mean, has this switch that he turns on once he walks out. And it doesn't matter if it's practice or a game. And you got to love that. I mean, that's what you want from a premier player. You want them to want the ball every second, no matter what the period is, whether it's a walkthrough or a practice period or a game. And right. and so I just love that about him. And, you know, he is a fiery competitor, and it's going to be fun getting him the ball.
Can you talk about the connection that he has with Aaron? We saw it last year before Aaron going down, but you've seen it here throughout the offseason as well. It's just continuing to grow.
Oh, it definitely is, and it needs to grow even more. As we get closer to the game, they still don't have a lot of game experience together. So it's one thing in practice to continually do it, but versus a very good defense that we go against every single day. But they got to get out there on the field and get that feel for each other and be able to, from the different checks and different audibles that we love to do, if we have advantageous looks and just continually develop together.
What kind of different looks do you expect from defenses after Brees put together that season? But now Aaron's coming back and he's healthy. You can't say to Aaron Rodgers, oh, we're just going to load up the box. We're going to stop the run. Go ahead, you know, try to beat us, because we've seen how that has worked. Nobody is ever going to approach defending Aaron like that.
Yeah, you know, being with him those 3 years at Green Bay, it was fascinating, because, you know, as coaches, you do everything you can to try to find different ways to get guys the ball, and you look at all the tendencies, you look at all the analytics, you look at all the numbers, and you know, I've been in situations when, you know, you tell Aaron that, hey, this is what you're going to get. Yeah, this is what they're going to do. And they give you something completely different. So it really ranges by game. Some guys have philosophies that they're going to just do exactly what they know, because right. they feel that's their best chance. Some guys wholesale change, and they'll play completely different defenses than they've ever done, or go, you know, out of their comfort level just to try to mess with Aaron a little bit. So we have to be ready for anything and everything all the time with him out there.
What's the luxury as a play caller if you're in a walkie-talkie out here, or it's in-game, you're in the booth and you call that play, knowing that Aaron has seen everything a defense could possibly throw at him? So there are times maybe you're sitting there up there as a play caller and you get cut off. Maybe you don't like that play, but he has the ability to help you get into something else.
Yeah, the great thing about Aaron is whenever we talk about a play, everything for us is about the intention of the play. You call it for a purpose, something that you're truly trying to attack. And not every play works versus everything. Otherwise, everybody in the NFL would probably call that exact same play over and over again. So there's different ways to take things away. So Aaron gives you that ability that he knows why that play was called, so he can get you to something else. I think that's something that we're always pushing and striving for, is we know we wanted this versus whatever we were looking for. Right. Hey, they didn't give it to us. They changed it up. Okay, Aaron, let's get to something else and let those guys get used to that potentially changing, so we can get a premier play.
Can you talk about his memory? The way he reflects on maybe something that happened in 18 or 15, like everything, as far as this is where they had an edge rusher come free from the left side. The safety was sneaking up over here. I saw that. Can you talk about those conversations that you guys have in the meeting room? And isn't it something truly unique as far as what he brings to the table from the mental part of the game?
It is. You know, as a coach, I feel like we memorize every single play that we've ever called or been a part of.
Yeah.
And some players have that ability. Some just kind of play each play and then, you know, don't remember it. I mean, this guy, you know, anytime you're going to present him with something, you have to be sure you've checked it all the way back to when he first started playing, because you'll be sitting there and he'll say, you know, oh, I remember in 2010 when I threw this ball to the right and had to sidestep left. And I mean, you're just like, really? And then you always want to go back and check it. And the farthest he'll be off is maybe the quarter. You know, from the game. He might have said second quarter and it was first quarter, but it's uncanny.
What's he been like this time around, coming off the Achilles? Because you guys talked about when he came back to practice last year. I know Brick was in here just a couple days ago and saying, you know, he's slicing and dicing us up. Pisses you off when you're playing against him. But knowing that he's 40, knowing this is the second time around, he's going to turn 41 in December, and knowing a lot of people are counting him out this time, how different is it?
I heard the 40 was the new 20.
Yeah.
So, and that's kind of his, you know, how he's presented himself. You know, I mean, he's young and spry and fired up. I think he's really enjoying himself. Yeah. We're doing as much as we can to try to stimulate him, and because there's certain plays that he's done so many times, and so you want to try to find ways to spice it up for him, whether it's with different players or different looks or different personnel, different formations. And I think he's really enjoyed it, and all the things that we're trying to do to just try to help him grow and enjoy himself.
Have you been able to take a sigh of relief? Games haven't been played, I know this. But that's awfully difficult for any play caller in the National Football League to not only lose your quarterback, but you had 13 different offensive line combinations. Now when you see Tyron Smith and you see John Simpson, and you see Morgan Moses, you see Olufashinu, you see these other depth pieces who've been able to get some good reps out here, like the Carter Warrens of the world, or Wes, or Max, and the list goes on. Does it get you excited for the potential of this group up front after everything you guys endured last year?
Yeah, no, I mean, you're right. There was a lot of things that we had to, it was a lot of adversity.
Yeah.
And I think with adversity builds strength. And like you had said, I think some of that experience that the guys had, whether it was the young wide receivers, the offensive linemen that were just coming into the building and starting right away or having to go right in, it's something that is great for them to be able to grow and get that game tape, feel more confidence. And for us, you know, you can't necessarily get excited yet. They're still a long ways away. Like you said before, that first game, we still have a lot of work to do. The guys got to get on the same page. We need to have some consistency. And I think as that, you know, we slowly get closer and closer, I think that's when that excitement will build.
What's the most impressive thing about Tyron?
I mean, he's a very, very big human being that can move well. I mean, that's probably the nicest way. I mean, you see him walk out there, and I mean, he's a specimen.
Yeah.
And then watching his body control, his ability to run. I mean, he had a couple things he did today that, I mean, just some moves that he was able to pick up with, you know, very elite, quick twitch defensive ends that, I mean, it's unbelievable.
He's so natural and so fluid. It's crazy.
It is. He doesn't lose a step. He doesn't waste a step. And he's unbelievably talented. So, you know, it's been fun to get to know him. He's a really, really good dude. And I'm excited to have him here.
What about John Simpson? He really revitalized his career in Baltimore with a breakthrough. Now you guys bring him in.
I'll tell you, he had really great tape last year. Yeah. I thought he did some really good things, and we were so excited to be able to get him. And it's another guy, you know, it's another, just from a personality standpoint, I mean, it's such a great culture fit to go in that room. And, you know, he's had a lot of success. He, Morgan Moses, playing together at Baltimore and the success that they had, and being able to bring that leadership and that experience in there is great. And just watching John out there play and run around, I mean, another really big athlete that has a great attitude.
Was it big for you guys to find a permanent home? I'm not going to put this in ink, but you're going to pencil it in. Elijah Vera Tucker, who Robert Saleh said today, we expect him to be ready to go for training camp. He's working off to the side. Going to be a right guard now.
Oh, it's going to be great for him. Yeah. I think just to be able to stay at one position, lock it in there, and really try to develop and, you know, maximize all of his potential. I think he's excited about it. We're excited about it. And I just want him to be able to be back out there. It's been since, I think, like week five or so. So it'll be good to have him back.
I know. And you guys get the Broncos here, so you don't got to worry about going to Denver this year. Unfortunately, each of his last 2 years ended at Denver. Broncos are coming here. We don't got to worry about that this year. Mike Williams. Obviously, he's working his way back from the ACL. It's probably a similar plan that you guys had with Brees in terms of medically. What did you like about the tape that Mike has put forth throughout his career as a Charger?
I mean, he's been an elite player in this league for a long time. I mean, his ability to get down the field, whether it's the contested 50-50 balls, routing people up, doing different things. I mean, he's shown that he can consistently win. And I think that's something, you know, for a guy like Aaron, for Tyrod, those two guys, to have a guy like that out there, you know, a veteran guy that can stretch the field, can do some of those big body things. That's something all quarterbacks love.
Do you like his personality? He seems like a fun guy to be around. And we can say that about a lot of these guys.
It's a good group. It's a real good group of men. I mean, I'm really, really excited to work with all of them. And adding Mike to it, I mean, he's been a great addition. I mean, he hasn't been able to be out there with us, but you see him on the side. He's working his tail off, and that's all you can ask for. And he's picking up the system and getting ready to get back.
How's the rookie Malachi Corley adapting to the league, just in terms of practices and what you guys are asking him to do? Because at WKU, they're trying to get the ball in his hands But you guys are going to do a lot of different things in terms of what you're going to ask him to do route-wise.
Yeah, you know, he had a great college highlight tape. I mean, we talked about him being the yak king, and you know, when he gets the ball in his hands, he is dynamic. I mean, it's all over the tape. I mean, he's hunting up contact. He embraces it. But you know, he's a rookie, and rookies need some time to develop, and it's a new system. There's lots of formations, lots of routes, and we're trying to kind of throw everything at him and see what sticks and see where that goes.
What's he like in the classroom? Because he seems like he's got a good way about himself.
He does. He does. It's all the rookies got to work hard. Yeah. It's a big change once you get to this level.
Speaking of big changes, you mentioned Xavier before. Do you sense something different from him now that he's got a year under his belt?
Oh, well, it's like we said. I mean, the experience that he got last year is priceless.
Yeah.
I mean, we all know about his speed. We all know what he could do punt returning, and the confidence that he got last year. I think he had a touchdown on a sweep and had a couple catches here and there. But you know, it was brand new for him.
Right.
You know, it's a long season. You know, 17 game season for all the rookies. It's hard to kind of get used to that first year, and now he knows, and he got that experience. I mean, he's a tough kid, awesome person, love being around him, and you know, we just want to keep pushing him and let him utilize that juice.
Let's talk about your wide tight end group. The guy keeps on popping on the screen to me, who had an under the radar season last year, is Tyler Conklin. I mean, he had 60-plus catches last year, so that was a career high. I'm just wondering what his capabilities are playing with Rodgers for a full year. But can you talk about the group as a whole, not just Conk, but Rucker? We see Yeboah out there flashing. Zach Kuntz entering year two.
Yeah, all those guys. I mean, they're such a versatile group. I think anytime you have a tight end position, you're always kind of searching for that guy that can do a little bit of everything, whether it's pass protect, run block, run routes, stretch the field. And from that standpoint, those guys are really good. I mean, you could put all three out there and you could throw the ball. You could put all three out there and pound the rock. So I think all of them, they all work well together. They all really cheer each other on. They support each other. They love working together. They love being out there with each other. And that's what you're looking for first and foremost. So just to see them develop as a group, you know, Coach Middleton, I think, is just done such a great job with those guys. I mean, Ruck's doing all kinds of different stuff. Tyler, like you said, I mean, he's doing a lot of stuff in the pass game and still excelling in the run game. So all of them, it'll be fun once we get the pads on to see how much farther they can go, but it's a good group to be with.
What's Conk's best ability receiving wise? What sets him apart?
I can't give you that secret.
Come on.
You know,
people have talked about contested catches.
I'll tell you, he had a couple really nice ones last year.
Yeah.
I mean, when he had a guy draped all over him, he was able to jump, extend his hands out there and make those tough catches. But he has this natural savvy about him when he runs routes, whether it's the first level or second level. He has the ability to snap down, shake some people up. It's one of those things you don't know if he can, but he's just got a little bit of wiggle to him. So it's been fun to watch that develop.
Yeah, I think he could have a big year for you guys. How about a couple new assistants on your staff? Sean Jefferson leading up the wide receivers.
OG.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a guy. I mean, obviously he did it for a long time in this league. And he's a great man. Getting to know him, I had only met him a couple times before he came here, but you know, he's a great man. I mean, he's been doing this for a long time, and he's old school as old school comes. You know, I mean, it's about running hard and really.
But the guys gravitate towards him. He played, like you said, he played in the league, but at the same time, he asks a lot of them, but nobody's saying, nah, I don't want to do it that way.
No doubt. I mean, it's, you know, kind of like having a guy like Ron Middleton. You know, you got Ron, who played years in the league. You got Sean, that's played years in the league. Both of those guys, you know, gone to the Super Bowl, won it, all that kind of stuff. And, I mean, it's instant credibility. You know, they're not going to ask you to do something that they didn't do themselves.
Right.
So I think that's something that those guys really, really appreciate.
What about Tony Douth? Now, he's working with a lot of young running backs behind Breece there. And Breece is still young himself.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, Tony's another really great guy, and just being around him, his energy and his love for the game, his voice, it carries across the whole field now. You can hear him from a mile away, and really have enjoyed working with him. And, you know, I think he's going to be great for those young backs. You know, he's worked with some young backs, some decent backs past couple years at Tennessee. It was a pretty good one there.
Yeah.
So, and he knows this system. He knows what we're looking for, and he holds them accountable, and you hear it.
I know you're not going to get ahead of yourself, and you cautioned me when we're talking about rookies, but what do you think about Braylon Allen and Isaiah Davis here early on in their career, and what they bring to the table, maybe what they were asked to do collegiately and what they've done in short so far?
No, you know, they've done a really good job. Like I said, it's always these rookies.
Yeah.
You know, you get very excited about them, and but it is a different speed. It's a different level,
yeah.
You know, from the pass protection demands that they have to understanding the routes, and then at the same time, just being able to run the ball. So there's so many things to learn in this game, and I think that they're really just, you know, head first, diving in and trying to grasp as much as they can. And then you throw a guy like Aaron Rodgers back there that puts a lot of demands on them also. But just their communication, they're really working hard to learn it all so they can come out and help us out, us on the field.
One of the things that Brian Baldinger and I were talking about last week was one of the plays that you had Isaiah move in. He went in motion and Aaron was working some cadence, which he always does, and you saw Isaiah go a little bit too quick, and then that's part of the learning process, right? Especially for a young back and those offensive linemen.
I'll tell you, with Aaron's cadence, it's everybody that hasn't been with him.
Right.
That definitely takes some time. He has been a cadence master for quite some time now, and it takes him getting used to.
Yeah.
But those guys, that's just another thing. I didn't even add that on the other list of everything. So, they'll slowly get it. We just, those rookies, it takes some time.
Have you let your mind think about, hey, we are built to be an all-weather team here? I mean, you're talking about what you guys did with the offensive line. Brees added some big young backs to the mix as well.
I think we have the biggest running back group. I mean, these guys are huge.
But was that when you guys are going through the scouting process and Joe D's bringing you in and you're talking to the staff and things like that, to your point, are you guys thinking, hey, listen, we got a lot of pieces here, but we want a mindset where when it is December and January, we can lean on you.
That's when you got to play your best football.
Right.
And I learned last year pretty quick. I think it rained every single game that we had. So, you know, you can never predict the weather. It's something that you always have to adjust to, but it's always good to have some big backs and big offensive linemen. So when you need to, you can run the ball downhill.
How about the competition on both sides of the ball? I know you got a lot of respect for Brick, but that defense that you guys have an opportunity to see every day, how much does that help you from a coaching perspective, also the players as far as that talented group?
So much. I mean, just like you said, you know, Brick is awesome. I mean, such a great guy. The whole defensive staff, you know, getting to know them going into that second year, again, it's not putting in a system. It's not putting in the formations, the plays, the run plays, the pass protections. And you're so focused on getting those guys ready that now just even the interaction of talking with the defense, hey, how can we push you? What can we give you? What would make it harder on you? Just all those conversations are so good for us just as a team, because we want to test them. They want to test us. I mean, they're already going to test us because they've been together for, I mean, gosh, they're going on their fourth year.
Right.
A lot of those guys have been in that system, so they know the intricacies, and now we can dive into that stuff and give them the things that we think might hurt them, and they can adjust and we adjust. So it's just been great collaboration.
I've asked you this before. I think your dad was out here today, former Jets offensive coordinator, Paul Hackett. How has the game changed from an OC spot from the game that your dad called in the early 2000s? And where are we going right now overall?
Oh, it's so different. I mean, we look at some of that tape from back in the days. It's funny. I always talk to my dad. You know, he never called one play when the quarterback was in the gun alignment. So you go back to those days when they were really good in the early 2000s.
Yep.
And the quarterback was under center. It was 2 minute. He was under center. I mean, that just shows how much the defenses have changed over time in the past 20 years that, you know, they're giving you so many different looks. You almost have to do that just for protection issues. So it has changed. And, you know, just I think the movement, you know, the players, you know, there's some differences there, just different things. But in the end, it's still all football. We ran a play today that was a play that I know my father's called numerous times.
Really?
And we were able to score a touchdown on it. So even the old stuff still works sometimes.
Did you wink at him or what?
I haven't gotten to talk to him about it, but I know he's going to say something tonight.
So, but speed and space game, though, because this is something I was talking to Brick about. When he played in the National Football League in the early 2000s with the San Francisco 49ers, he said, hey, I was first and second down linebacker. Then I came off the field. I said, hey, Brick, could you play in today's NFL? You know, he's a humble guy, much like yourself. So he said, no, I couldn't play in today's NFL. But Quincy Williams is a great example of the modern day linebacker. Whew. And you can make the argument that he is one of the best middle linebackers in the National Football League. I don't even think you can argue about it. But
he is so good. He's fast, but
speed and space. Can you talk about that? That you want to get the ball in your playmaker's hands and stretch the field, but also how the counter is the evolution there.
I mean, we're always looking to have the defense cover the whole field, whether it's sideline to sideline in the run game or vertically and horizontally down the field. And, you know, when you have elite players these days, especially some of the guys on our defense, I mean, they're so fast. And when they can just play and react, I mean, you have to be on point in everything you do on offense, because that's the essence of the defense. Is they're simple, but they know all the intricacies of it. And, you know, guys like Quincy, I mean, you want to run outside, you better, you know, those linemen better run, because he's gonna roll. And then you have to have counters off of it. It forces you to have to do whatever you can to create, as we like to say, consternation, so that they can't just react fast. We want to make them hesitate or think and make it so they can't play as fast, because they're already unbelievable athletes. So it's a great chess game back and forth.
You guys got some speed on offense now. I mean, I know you had it last year, but when you think about the big picture, you got a lot of guys out there sub 4.4 who could get somewhere in a hurry.
Yeah, no, that's always good to have speed.
Yeah.
Speed and intelligence is an exciting thing.
All right, so what's the plans for the summer? How are you going to get ready for this thing? You got to get away for a little bit, right?
Got to get away. As we've all seen, we've got ourselves a heck of a schedule, especially early. You know, you've got a long training camp, but I think this is the time now for all the coaches to get away, be with their families, the players to be with their families, train, just enjoy, you know, just not having to do anything. And then, because once we get rolling there, I think it's July 24th or 25th, whenever they all report back, it's full go.
It's on.
No doubt.
Yeah. You like those joint practices nowadays with the three preseason games?
I do. I think it's a good, you know, training camps are so long.
I mean,
you have all those weeks before, then you got the three preseason games, and you got the 2 weeks before the first game. And so it's just, it's extended period of time. So to break it up, I always think that's something good. See a different defense, not having to go against the same guys all the time, brings that team camaraderie together, because you're cheering for your defense. The defense is cheering for you instead of going after each other every single day. So I think it's always a good way to break up camp.
All right. So let's end here. When do you start looking at the Niners?
Hey, I'm just trying to get through these next couple days.
Thanks, Nate. Appreciate it.
All right, anytime.